Welcome to Real Flix Reviews. We're like a book club for people who hate reading, and this is our shenanigans episode. This is last year in review. This week we have Jonathan Charney, James Stevens,
hello,
and Ryan Preston. This week it's our shenanigans episode. This is the week that we talk about every single movie we picked last year. And James, you want to go through the list?
All right. Initially, we have you with your first pick of Red Line, which was an anime. That was a pretty good one.
Okay, let's wrap this up quick. We're gonna be here forever.
Okay. next, we got Drive, which was me. Lost Boys, Ryan. Lockout, which was Theater. Troll Hunter, John. Battle Royale, which was me. Super, Ryan. Avengers, Theater. Alien, John. Dark Angel, aka I Come in Peace, which was me. Being John Malkovich, Ryan's fault. Prometheus, Theater. Forbidden Planet, John. Rebuttal was Attack of the Killed Tomatoes, me. Rebuttal on that was Buffalo 66. Then we went to the theater, and then we had Ghost in the Shell and A Beautiful Mind. Then Ryan came back with Green Street Hooligans, Theater again, which was Dark Knight Rises. Everything is Illuminated, John. Me, Neverland. True Grit was Ryan. Born Legacy was Theater. TMNT, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, John. Gantz and Gantz Perfect Dancer was me. Warrior was Ryan. And then we did Seven Psychopaths at the theater. Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter, John. Warlock was me. Rebuttal was There Will Be Blood, Ryan. Skyfall, The Shawshank Redemption, Inglourious Bastards, Pulp Fiction, Reservoir Dogs. So that's all the picks.
So you want to explain what we're doing? Who wants to explain?
I'll take it, unless Ryan wants to jump on board.
That's bad with me. Basically, this is the shenanigans episode, where we just basically are just going to bullshit and shenanigans about all the movies that we've seen, more or less. But we're going to break it down a little bit better and try to give our best, worst, and regret picks. Movies that we sort of apologize for making.
So can I go first?
Oh, John's so trying to jump on this.
I want to go first.
Oh, please, John.
So here's the,
you.
What should right. we do? Should we do We're, our well, favorite pick, worst pick, or you regret?
I think we got to start with our favorite. I think we should start on a good note and then just take it down and just beat its
crap.
Leave
a real fucking sour taste in everybody's mouth.
Yeah, exactly.
I actually have two favorite picks.
You can't have two favorite picks. Well, you got to pick one.
I liked both of them.
It's against the rules.
Well, I'm breaking the rules.
I don't know. I'm going to regret. I have two.
Here's the thing is these are two movies that I didn't own that I want to buy. And that to me sets the level of how much I like them. Green Street Hooligans, I bought. I love the movie.
It is a good movie.
I didn't actually want to see it when it first came out. And because of the show, I saw it. And I'm glad I actually saw it.
Okay.
And the other one is Everything is Illuminated. I love the movie. It's one of my all-time favorite. You know, if people want to see a good movie, that's always the movie I say they need to see.
Okay.
That's generally my top.
So apparently somebody's in love with Elijah Wood.
I know. I'm like, really?
I have a hard time.
City in there, too?
Yeah, go out and watch North, everybody.
Make sure you drink heavily beforehand.
What was it? Yo Gabba Gabba or something?
Ooh.
Hey, the only reason why I know about that is because I have a 5-year-old, and after the first episode of Yo Gabba Gabba, she ain't watching it again.
That's good.
I was in the
that
room.
Her own choice, or did you shoot the TV like Elvis?
Well, I wanted to. I wanted to shoot the TV and smash my Xbox because it was on Netflix, and I'm like, I can't afford that. All right, kid, you're never watching that again.
Well, here's the thing, and anybody who knows me, I thought I'd never ever say this. Is Green Street and Everything is Illuminated changed my mind a little bit on Elijah Wood? Because when you have North, Flipper, and some of his back catalog, it doesn't give you great hope in his ability as an actor.
Yeah, it really doesn't.
Either that or he should fire his agent.
Yeah, I think he needs to shoot his agent in the face.
Because those are some of my favorite, and plus those are really only the good movies he's done.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, Ryan, what are you on?
Is this my favorite one?
Yeah.
It was kind of a toss-up between a couple of them, but I had to go Inglourious Bastards. I'll watch that movie like at any time ever.
Sucking up to James, I see.
No,
well, it's just one of those. I don't give a shit if it's on cable. If I turn it on halfway through, I'm gonna be like, oh, this is on. Sit down and watch.
Well, you know,
That and Shawshank Redemption, because it's on every day.
It's on all the time. Ryan literally took my favorite, because, I mean, that's...
I knew we were going to cross over on that.
I know it was a toss-up.
Never cross the streams, man. Don't cross the streams. But,
I mean, I've been... I watched... When did we watch this one? This was, what, 3 weeks ago?
Three weeks ago.
We watched this one 3 weeks ago, and, you know, I've had Igor Stieglitz stuck in my head.
Yeah. I can still hear the beating of the bat against the wall as the bear juice coming out.
Still a great scene,
you
though.
Know, actually, one of the things, I was just thinking about this the other day, and I wished I had said this for the show when we actually did it, is, you know, the scene with the baseball bat, you think it's going to be like this epic and really cool scene, but, I mean, as soon as he whacks the guy in the head, you see the blood squirt, and you just hear the silence of this guy getting beat to death. It's very humbling.
And then you hear the silence of the crowd watching the movie, and then everybody's stomach kind of just turn a little bit like, oh, shit.
He did it, the realism of that guy getting beat to death with a baseball bat was a really well-done scene, because it's not a pretty scene.
Well, no,
it's a very hardcore.
It was the anti-glorifying of somebody getting beat to death.
So what does that say about me? Because I was laughing my ass off during this scene. I was like, yes, harder, home run. You know, I was like one of the few people actually laughing, and the whole theater was looking at the group of us laughing too.
I've seen this movie. It's only been out for what, 3 years, 4 years?
Three or four.
3 years in 2009. And I think it was around wintertime, Christmas that it came out.
Because we saw it together.
Yeah. You know, I've seen this movie since it came out probably about close to 10 times in 3 years. Yeah. Very close to that. And I think it was about the third time is when I really took in how well he did that scene of how it's not a glorified scene.
No.
It's a very humbling scene. And yeah, the first time, I admit, I was laughing. But after watching it again and again and again, I just am amazed at the realism and how well he did with just that part.
Because I love the lead up to it, the scene he's in the hallway. I think that right there is going to be a classic clip in history and cinema, because knock. You know, it's
right. Just
the lead up to it is an amazingly well done, and I think it's a very... Yeah. It's a very downplayed scene, because they could have done, like, you know, James said, they could have done like Sin City, super of the top blood squirting. Instead, it's super underplayed, which is really well done.
Yeah, I was just amazed by that. And
not what I was expecting. For
no, I wasn't either. So I thought that scene was really well done, and it wasn't. It does a lot of justice to that. So on to our worst, and I'll take this one. I mean, Ryan. Hey, please pick me. You know, there's a lot of movies in here that, I mean, a couple of them are mine, but I narrowed it down, and I got to say, you know, you lost me at tentacle porn, so it's super. I mean, that one to
you
me.
Son of a bitch.
You know,
Why would you do that?
Because it's a wannabe kickass, and it wasn't good enough. It's such a wannabe kickass to me.
No, this is the movie that ranked kickass.
Yeah.
They were probably being made at the same time.
Tentacle porn.
You can't say that one wanted to be the other. It takes like 3 years to make these fucking things.
Tentacle porn.
Okay, look, that was awesome. And it wasn't tentacle porn. It was tentacle touching his brain.
He was watching tentacle porn when it happened.
Okay, so this is mild tentacle porn. Super.
Okay, so yeah, I mean, that's my worst. That's the worst pick to me. I mean, there's a couple other ones, and I'm gonna get into them in the regret picks, of some that. So I didn't want to put my regret picks in my worst pick. So it was toss up between like four.
So okay, so I guess it's mine.
No, I think it's Ryan. I think Ryan's got to defend himself here.
Now,
I want to see what Ryan's doing.
I mean, just, you know, I'd be happy if anybody who ever watches this thing, if you've ever seen Super and like the movie, please. Cuss him out for a couple of
minutes. Send me some hate mail. I don't care.
Yeah, troll him for a little while.
Great, all three of you. And
whatever.
Ryan's included
in
it.
Fuck you guys.
I'm going home.
Not a fucking good movie that I couldn't believe I had to sit through this shit again.
Which one?
There was a couple of parts that were almost too uncomfortable for me to watch that I kind of skipped forward about 2 minutes at a time.
Okay, what is it? What is it?
Warlock.
Okay.
Who was that? Who picked that again, James?
Me. I raised my hand. Yeah, that was me.
Oh, Jesus.
It wasn't me, kid.
Oh, man.
I wouldn't have picked that movie.
So I'm thinking, oh, maybe this might be funny. You know, this might be a little campy. This would be cool. I haven't seen this movie in 15 years, whatever the hell. Oh, man. I was sitting there like, what the hell? I don't know. It was probably 4 when it came out. I probably saw it when I was like 7 or 8 or something like that. Well, obviously, my parents didn't give a shit.
Yeah, you're about 4.
But just, oh, man. That just movie watching that again, it was just embarrassing.
That movie aged as well as Lindsay Lohan.
Ooh. Wow.
I think they were born cold. The same year, too.
And I'm not sure who that's against either.
The movie Warlock.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's a diss on Lindsay Lohan or Warlock.
Oh, maybe it's the diss on the year 1989.
So, mine is, my worst pick is Super.
Really?
Holy shit!
Come
on!
You really passed up... You passed up Lost Boys for Super?
I'll be honest. Lost Boys, even Buffalo 66.
Okay, fucking Surf Nazi beat out Tentacle Porn.
Yes. I'll be
Jesus,
completely
there
honest.
There is no fucking justice here.
No, it's my show, damn it. Our show, technically.
Yeah, it's our show.
No, you'll be honest. Wow. I liked Lost Boys. It was entertaining enough to make fun of. Buffalo 66 was even a decent movie. As worse, it was just... No, this is a movie.
Span time.
Huh?
We're going to span time.
Buffalo 66.
Span time.
Oh. Super was, you know, if it's on at 3 in the morning and I'm drunk off my ass, I still wouldn't watch this movie. I'd rather watch a rousing movie of, just about anybody than this. I hate Rainn Wilson with a passion of 1,000 burning suns. I don't think he's funny. I don't think somebody beating him to death with a bat would be funny. So there's just no chance of me liking this movie.
Oh, man.
Anyway, wow. All right, I wasn't expecting...
Rainn Wilson and James Gunn, if you're watching this, I'm sorry. I liked your movie.
I'm kind of surprised that, I mean, like, Super got 2.
So should
two
I,
picks and
should,
worse.
Should I jump to the next one, then?
Yeah, I guess so.
The next one is you regret picking or watching.
Well, yeah, it is, but we were going to let... John,
because apparently he doesn't regret anything that he picks.
No,
jeez,
well,
I don't know why.
I'll be honest. I
he's
like,
got some things to regret.
Well, here's the thing, and even with Super, every movie we've picked this last year is there's things you can pick out of it you didn't like. Even though I picked Super as the worst movie, there's still things you can see. Okay, I don't like this actor. I don't like this style of directing. There's stuff you can pick from it. So I generally, movie wise, don't regret movies I watch. But the movie I regret watching is it's the scene where Rainn Wilson is changing in his car. And Super.
Wait.
I could have gone without seeing that.
You can't.
That was like my favorite scene.
I don't really know if I can allow John to have a regret and a worst of the same movie. What do you think, Ryan?
I think this is entirely egregious, and we should cut him off right now.
Well,
start
guess,
censoring out his face on
oh,
the screen.
Oh, jeez.
Well, guess who's in charge of everything? That's not gonna happen.
I can do this. I don't know. I think you need to pick something else. I really do. I think you need to go through the list, and I think you need to pick something besides Super for both. And while that's going on, I'm gonna throw in my regret picks.
Wait. You were afraid to hand me the list because you've written on it. Don't you forget nobody can read your handwriting?
Shut up.
Even your mom is like, what the hell?
No, she can decipher it. My two regrets, and
my mom just can't decipher your shit.
It's a double. I have two regrets here. Are you talking? Ryan?
What?
I think we lost sync with you.
Yeah, we're off sync a little bit.
Are you back?
Well, that's awesome. Just
okay.
Continue.
Anyway, my two regrets are either Attack of the Killer Tomatoes or Drive.
You should regret picking those two.
Particularly Attack of the Killer Tomatoes, because I was with you on Drive as far as like, no, you shouldn't like this movie.
Yeah. Well, you know, I have a reason for picking Drive, and the reason why was because I wanted to show people how bad of a movie that really was, because it had a, what, like an 8 or a 9 on IMDb?
Oh, yeah, no, everybody seemed to universally love that movie, and I wanted to make a fucking PowerPoint presentation that just, you know, went from slide to slide showing exactly how shitty that movie was.
Yeah,
wait, you hated the movie, so you decided to take it out on us.
Yeah.
No, I'm the one that picked it.
Well, yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah, I was the one that picked it, so, I mean, and you hadn't seen it, Ryan had seen it. Yeah. So that's one of those, and then... I picked Attack of the Killer Tomatoes just because I wanted to ruin your guys' vision of Attack of the Killer Tomatoes.
How couldn't you ruin something that was bad to begin with?
Because, I mean, it's one of those things that you'd seen as a kid, but seen in
adult. Yeah, I'm definitely of that. I'm younger than all of you, so yeah, I saw it when I was a kid and it had fond memories and then watched it again and was like, God damn it, why? I was a stupid kid.
Exactly. So that's kind of why I did it, was to ruin your childhood.
Fair enough.
So, but I think, watching it again for, I think, the second time as an adult, it was one of those that I'm like, why the hell did I do this to myself again? So, that one was a regret, but, I sat through it and I did it, but Drive, I mean, seeing that movie twice is just, it's disgusting.
Yeah.
It's like Taxi Driver. I mean, I'm not going to sit through that crap again.
It was not as bad as Taxi Driver.
No, I'm saying it's not.
Okay.
But I'm just saying that, I don't want to sit through Taxi Driver again. Why would I sit through Drive again,
Yeah, I've seen it once. I have no desire ever to watch it again.
Yeah, so I've seen it twice. Think about that. That's like, I know I torture myself too much with movies.
Okay, well, since you two elected that my my pick didn't count, I'm picking Being John Malkovich.
Really?
Shit.
I hate that movie.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I feel like I'm under attack in this episode. This is bullshit.
Hey, I'm with you on Being John Malkovich.
Okay, thank God.
You got somebody else here who's John like, now. Really?
I'll be honest. I didn't see the movie before.
Do you know what we rated that one? I think you rated like a 2, but what?
I rated
what did
it
I rate
pretty
it?
Low. I don't know.
I think it was a 3. I don't think I can do 4.
I'll be honest. I just didn't like the premise.
Really?
Yeah. It's the acting was good. It was just the story I didn't like. It really comes down to the actors did good. They had people I liked. I just didn't like the story.
Really?
That's just what it came down to.
John gave it a 2, James 3, and I give it 4.
Okay. I thought I gave it a 3. I was just going to have to pull it up and double check. But, I wouldn't expect that one to be your regret pick.
Yeah, wow. Really. I would have let you keep bagging on Super if you were to
that. See that. I warned you guys, but no,
wow,
you didn't.
Being John Malkovich, really?
I just don't like the movie. I just never
send
liked
all
the
your
premise.
Hate mail towards John Charney.
I mean, you really didn't. You liked.
I liked Super
Buffalo
better.
66 over Being John Malkovich. Is it Super?
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow. Okay.
Wow.
I'm baffled by that also. And one that I think we can all universally agree on, even the audience as well. I'm really sorry, everybody. I picked Lost Boys.
The worst.
My first one, and that was.
You need to fix that.
That was not cool of me. I should have done that to you guys. And I'm sorry.
The funniest thing is about that is I told people that it's like, hey, we're doing the Lost Boys this week. I had a couple of people go, oh, that movie is awesome. And
right,
I look
yeah,
at him
and
going,
then all of a sudden I get served with a class action lawsuit for people going blind having to stare at the surf Nazi again.
The funniest thing is I looked at him going, when's the last time you saw it? Oh, I saw it last week. It's an awesome movie. It's like,
wow. I mean, really? That person needs to be kneecapped.
I don't know. She has
really?
She's pretty
Lost
cute.
Boys? Lost Boys was the one that you decided to regret, huh?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Why?
You
why?
You get a lot more choices than that.
This? What?
You get a lot more choices than that.
What else? Okay, what should I have picked? Oh, Wise One.
Well, I mean, here,
you
let's
sure you
want to
give
list
that?
Lost Boys is far worse than Buffalo 66. It's
yes.
Far worse than Super.
Wait, you sure you want to give him the title as Wise One? Because you're going to regret that in later episodes.
Well, I'm looking at it. And
I said it sarcastically. I think everybody realizes that.
Yeah, but James doesn't
except
care.
James. It's just going to
no,
his...
I don't give a crap.
James doesn't care. He'll still say it.
You really think that Lost Boys... You even agree with him on this, that Lost Boys is worse than Buffalo 66?
Mm. Yes. Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
Why? Is that because you got eye candy in the movie?
I think Buffalo 66 had somewhat of a point where Lost Boys
it had a purpose for being made. It was kind of a... it was an indie director who had this kind of interesting story. Then obviously, apparently, to you fuckers, wasn't executed in the most perfect way possible with the $200,000 that he did the movie with. But, you know, it was, yeah, it was much better than Lost Boys.
Oh, yeah. And don't forget, it was made, Lost Boys was made in the 80s, so you had some of the 80s
soundtrack
sheen off of it.
Yeah.
And are you really going to take Super to the grave that it's a good movie?
Yes. Well, no. Okay, look, I won't defend it as the greatest movie ever. I'll defend it as an average movie, but I really like the movie. That's all I'm going to say.
Would you buy it on DVD?
Sure. Yeah,
he would. I mean, he probably even has Lost Boys on DVD and VHS.
Of course,
the only reason I would buy that is to burn it.
Of course, on the other hand, I don't really have the way to talk because I own the Beastmaster of Mark Singer on DVD.
It
was given to me, though, so technically I didn't pay for it.
You know, looking at it, and yeah, you kind of coming in a little bit late into the show, I guess, you know, Lost Boys would be your...
It was my first pick, and yeah, it was the one that I remember getting sort of ambushed on, and it was like, oh, I'm supposed to pick a movie. I forgot shit. And then it was it kind of came into my head as a joke, but then I couldn't get it out of my head, so I wasn't going to sit there for 30 minutes and figure out something, so I just said it, you know, whatever.
I have to say,
then I had to watch it, man.
My favorite description of so far of the episode, of any episode, takes place, and Ryan talks about, you know, his ragtag bunch of retards. This description of it is hilarious. It's my favorite description of any show.
Yeah, that was pretty bad. That was pretty good. I don't know. Honestly, I gotta say, out of all the movies that I picked, and I picked some abstract ones just to be a jackass, to be honest.
Just to be abstract.
Yeah, just be abstract and just to pick different ones that normally somebody who, let's pick a movie, wouldn't normally pick. Like, I mean, seriously, Attack of the Killer Tomatoes. How many people do you really know that are like, let's watch Attack of the Killer Tomatoes?
I don't know too many people nowadays don't even know what the movie is.
And, I mean, Gant. So,
no, nobody knows what the movie is unless there's like a drinking game that's involved with it.
Yeah, pretty much.
Sounds like a great way to kill yourself.
I gotta say, in that aspect, I gotta say, I don't really regret any of them. But I do have to say, I mean, there are some in there that I do regret watching. And unfortunately, they're on your side, Ryan.
Poor Ryan. Like what? Like what else?
Really?
What else
Super? Span Time. How many freaking times did that jerk say "span time" to her? What the hell does that even mean?
They were both crazy. You saw his parents. You'd be crazy too.
I mean,
yes.
It was a character story. You know, it was literally just about how wacky that guy was and how fucking easily led around the chick was.
Who were the brothers that shot their parents in the 90s, 80s?
Menendez
brothers, yeah. Why didn't he just go Menendez on them? I mean, seriously.
I don't know. Ask the Menendez brothers if that made him feel better.
I like the fact that there was a pause there.
I know, he kind of like paused.
Like I said, to think about it, like, ah, shit, I'd kill him too now.
No, exactly. It's like, really? You guys are psycho. Psycho. Anyway, but, you know, not to really pick on Ryan, but, I mean, Ryan... As far as looking at Ryan's picks, he went indie. He went indie film. And, you know, I can't knock him for that, but, I mean, there's better indie films than that.
Buffalo 66 is sort of like a standard indie film. You know what I mean? It's
a standard of crap?
I knew you were going to fucking say that.
You see, I don't think it's that bad. After watching it, months away from it, it's actually not that bad.
Thank you.
Thinking about it, I could definitely see things where it would be, if you want to get into an indie film, it's not super indie, but it's indie enough to, I think, to help introduce people to non-traditional, non-Hollywood.
Yeah, very, very non-traditional. It was still funny dialogue for a lot of the first and second act. Good performances turned in by Christina Ricci and Vincent Gallo.
Yeah, for such an awkward character on some of them, I thought they did pretty good.
His parents was funny.
If you're gonna pull that card, then I mean Napoleon Dynamite's a good movie.
Trying to kill the guy that blew the football game. That was kind of funny. His whacked out brother actually went on to become somewhat of a respected actor.
I will say James brought up something that I agree with. I think, far as Napoleon Dynamite goes, I think this is. it's a tie-in. I hate Napoleon Dynamite, but I think this so is this and Napoleon Dynamite. I think on some areas, the awkwardness of the characters. I think.
I mean, if you not throw as much, if you throw it in there, I mean, Napoleon Dynamite had funny points.
No,
you may not know. Hold on. Stop.
On yourself.
Stop.
That movie sucks so much, asshole.
Hold on. Let me finish.
Oh, sure. You're going to rip fucking Super new one and then fucking sit there and tell me that Napoleon Dynamite had funny moments?
Yeah. I mean, right. if you're sitting there in that bus scene, when that old man is sitting there with a shotgun, point blank range on that cow, I remember in the theater, because I saw it because a friend dragged me to it. And I'm sitting there in the theater and I started cheering for a school bus of children before it happened. And it happened.
See,
and I started laughing my ass off because that is a funny part.
Was it a male or female that dragged you to the
movie? Nicole.
See, so women generally drag guys.
Anyway, but I mean, if you're putting up the standard of awkward performances and then the Mexican guy, I mean, let me build you a cake.
It was a different kind of awkward. Oh, yeah. Oh, shit. The
Pedro.
Pedro. Thank you.
Oh, man.
I mean, if you're putting it up,
I swear to God, if I saw one more asshole walk around with a
vote Pedro shirt,
yeah, oh man, I was gonna lose it, dude.
So I mean,
I'm gonna start taking hostages.
What about
Moon
Boots?
Don't like Napoleon Dynamite. Don't get me wrong, I do not like Napoleon Dynamite at all. But if you're putting it on the scale of random indie films where awkwardness is the star point of that movie.
It's a different kind social of awkwardness, though. At least the Vincent
Napoleon Dynamite
awkwardness part was a little more. He was a little more of a dick. You know what I mean? He had a little more of this kind of just sort of criminal mentality. So you didn't feel super bad for him. I'm watching Napoleon Dynamite. Like, I don't even want to watch this kid be a fuck up. It's like when I was watching.
I agree with him on that, but.
Meet the Parents, I couldn't hardly get through because I'm sitting there just feeling bad for Ben Stiller. It's like, this is uncomfortable now. You know?
Yeah, see, I agree. I think if it was on the Napoleon Dynamite scale of awkwardness, I give a Buffalo 66 a 2. More than a 10. Because there were awkwardness, but I actually enjoy the characters of Christina Ricci and Vincent Gallo's because it's just like
Found them annoying.
Because
annoying as hell.
The Vincent Gallo character was just stupid. It's like, really, you're gonna do this? And Christina Ricci is just kind of going along with it.
But you know, this is the point of the show.
It's like, seriously, woman, you're smarter than him.
But we're getting to the real point of the show is that it's okay. I think Buffalo 66 is crap.
Oh, yeah, totally.
It's okay.
Acceptable. Yeah.
I mean, Ryan thinks some of my movies are crap. That's great. I don't care. But that's what we're trying to get the audience out there to do, too, is to watch something that you wouldn't normally watch. If you like it, you like it. If you don't, you don't. But
yeah, that's one of the reasons why I don't.
I mean, if you people out there like Napoleon Dynamite, that's cute. But as far as I'm concerned, it's a horrible movie. I mean, the only redeeming part of that movie is like 30 seconds.
There, that's fine. That's adorable. But you people suck and you should be killed.
I'll agree. It's one of the reasons why it's one of the reasons why I don't regret really any of the movies. Even the ones I bagged on, I'm glad I watched.
I think we said it in an episode. I can't remember when, but we all said like it's because we've seen some shitty movies that we really appreciate the good ones. And then we can sort of pick out, you know, intent versus execution and things like that. I mean, you obviously have to watch. You have to know how bad it can get. You know,
exactly.
Because I'll be straight up honest. There's Ryan's. Ryan have seen movies that I definitely would have never gone out of my way to watch.
Sure.
And same thing with James. And you sit us all together, and we've seen a ton of movies combined. So we get to see movies that we would never go out of our way to watch. And it's like, I liked that. I would never see it again. But it was a good movie. You know?
Yeah.
Right. Well, I would have never seen Forbidden Planet. But I enjoyed watching that movie on a number of different levels, on a camp level, on a serious level, on a kind of, you know, technological level. I mean, there was things that I enjoyed about it. Would have never, you know, tracked that movie down.
Yeah.
All right. So 70s version of Lord of the Rings is okay?
The cartoon?
The Hobbit?
No, the cartoon. No. There's the rotoscoped Lord of the Rings cartoon.
Yeah.
I never saw I saw the Hobbit cartoon 1970s.
I like the Hobbit. The rotoscoped Lord of the Rings looks like an acid flashback film.
Yeah.
It really does.
It's bad.
You know, I'm pretty sure there's people who've dropped acid that are freaking out. You know, it's like out of that movie. It's like, oh my God, you know.
Probably still permafried.
Yeah.
Not as bad as I one of the next this coming year, I'm gonna pick a movie. I think it's called The Wizard. It's one of the very first cartoon movies, and I'm gonna show you the pinnacle of it. Back in the time, this was considered a good cartoon. But it's you'll have to see it. Look it up. It's entertaining as hell.
Man.
I never said man. I have worse movies I can pick.
No, I know you do.
I can make us watch Mark Singer.
Anyways, guys out there, I mean, there's some movies that we got to say, you know, sorry for, but honestly, if it got you to watch it and you're starting to understand the genre, that's the whole point of the show.
I do have a question for both of you before we end up, because we're coming up towards the end of the show. Why do you like movies? What was the reason, you know, when you were a kid that got you into watching movies? Because it's different than television. It's different than books. What was the reason why you like it?
Ryan?
I think my parents still tell stories about me being 2 or 3 years old, and that was the only way to kind of sit me down and shut me up, you know, was to throw on a movie. And, you know, at that age, it was probably just a Disney movie or something like that.
Over and over and over.
Yeah, but I mean, that's the kind
Barbie
of thing. Like, I would sit there and watch, you know, Oliver and Company, you know, 13 times in a row. And it was just like, I don't know. I love the three-act structure of movies over TV. I've always, you know, preferred that kind of storytelling. I don't know. It's been the only thing that's sort of kind of kept me company my whole life. I love movies for a number of different reasons.
What about you, James?
You know, early, I guess, I can't remember, like, that being, like, stuff to get me to shut up or anything like that. But for me...
Because your mom would have just duct taped your mouth shut.
She probably told me to go outside and play or something. But, you know, for me, I always thought it was kind of fun to sit down and watch. I mean, back when I was a kid, most of the kid movies were like Old Yeller, Where the Red Fern Grows, you know.
Happy movies.
Yeah, really cheerful and happy movies, you know. And then the Star Wars trilogy, I remember fond memories of watching that like multiple times.
Oh, yeah.
Batteries not included.
Raiders of the Lost Ark, things like that. And I loved those movies because they were fantasy storytelling and they were really well done. Some of them, like you said, like, you know, Call of the Wild, those things, I think are kind of sad.
Pollyanna.
Yeah.
And look, I mean, as kids, I mean, we all started watching movies really young. I mean, that informed so much of how I viewed like adults and the world and businesses and things like that. I mean, it's to a kid, it's you're getting information that adults don't really give you. You know, like no adult sits you down and says, this is what it's like, you know, and then this is what adults really are. We're just, you know, old, stupid kids. Still,
well, I mean,
essentially, I nobody ever thinks that.
Most of the movies I'm talking about, I had already read the books, too. Like,
I was never a reader. So, I mean, it was just like whatever movie I could absorb. And then I had my grandmother, my dad's mom, had cable and all the HBO channels and everything, and she used to just give me the list of the movies that they would send her every month. You know, this is the movies that are coming out on HBO. She'd be like, oh, just pick whichever ones you want and I'll record them for you. Yeah. And she'd sit there and just record movies, and at a certain point I realized I could pick whatever I wanted. Yeah. So I'm picking shit like True Lies and Striptease and every rated R movie that was listed on that thing. So from a really young age, I got this kind of adult view of the adult world, which wasn't what the adults in my world were trying to feed to me. They were trying to feed me sort of the watered down kid version of real life.
I think,
but based on movies, I learned a ton of shit. You know?
I think for me personally, when it comes to movies, I love it. It transports you into a different world that's just generally completely different from yourself and where you live. I love good storytelling, whether it's sci-fi, drama, action. Like Forbidden Planet. I love the storytelling in that. It gives you a simpler view of the future. Nothing complex, nothing hard, hardcore, black and white hats. You know, I just love the storytelling. I love the fact that for half an hour to 3 hours, you're transported into a place that you'll never go. You'll never be Rambo. You'll never be Frodo.
You'll never be James Bond.
Yeah, and that's what I like. I love great storytelling. And that's one of the reasons I still love cartoons. And any medium where there's a story present, I generally like.
Well, what I was going to say is I like being able to see what somebody else's take on their fantasy is.
Oh, hardcore.
Like, I mean, I did not like the Lord of the Rings. And the reason why I didn't like the way they told Lord of the Rings is because they're trying to compete with my imagination as a 12-year-old kid.
Yeah.
Reading those. If I look at it from a different aspect of what my vision of it was, he did a fantastic job. But if I look at it as my 12-year-old imagination in comparison to his, it doesn't quite match up. So that's why I didn't enjoy it as much as I should have.
Well, what he did was he realized his version of Lord of the Rings. He didn't realize your version of Lord of the Rings.
Exactly. So,
well,
no. So that's where I enjoy movies.
I gotta say though, the two things is one of the reasons why I like Peter Jackson, and I like people like Peter Jackson, is because if you can get a fan, a true fan of a book or a comic, to do the movie, you know, at least in some areas they're gonna get it true to your vision.
Yeah.
Maybe not 100%.
Yeah, they're gonna get it with the heart in the right place.
Yeah.
At least.
Yeah.
Because there's part that I absolutely loathe about Lord of the Rings. There's a couple of spots. There's things missing.
Elijah Wood.
That's a different conversation. He was the best person they could have ever picked for that annoying role.
Yeah.
But so you know, that's the thing is. I lost train of my thought.
Sorry, my cord is wrapped around the foot. I thought I was gonna take it down.
Yeah. So. You know, I love good storytelling. The only thing that's sad about now is Hollywood just does a bunch of remakes, and it's missing. Yeah. The reason I like Tarantino and people like Tarantino and some Guy Ritchie films is there's a storytelling present that you don't see because it's a movie. They're fans of movies. They're fans of genres, and you can see their love for it in their film.
Yeah. And, you know, back in the day in what people, you know, probably refer to as the golden age or the silver age of Hollywood, whatever.
The golden age of Hollywood.
It's, somebody said, I can't remember who actually said it, but there's only three types of stories that are in existence that can be told. It's man, and by man, I mean, you know, like humankind, like man.
Sexist.
Yeah, exactly. Man versus man. Man versus his environment, and man versus himself. And every story you've ever seen is pretty much a derivative of one of those three things, you know?
Yeah.
Never thought about
and
that.
And it used
before.
To be sort of a challenge and an art form to take one of those three things and give it to you in a way that you hadn't seen before or with a slightly different twist on the same story. But it was always veiled. Like we're not trying to give you the same thing. You know, we're not saying it's one of these three things. We're trying to give you something that appears to be new, you know. Nowadays, it's like they're not even being that polite anymore. They're just saying, here's the next thing. Here's your next movie. Here's the next thing. Hey, you remember that shit from back in there? Here's that one for you.
I think part of it, I'll be honest, I think the veil of Hollywood is gone. With the internet and modern day, there's no mystery to filmmaking. There's no movie magic.
Yeah.
The benefit of that, though, is this upcoming soon, we're going to do a movie. We're going to be doing shorts. And the best part of that is you get to see young people, film students, whatever, with today's technology to do awesome 10-minute, 45-minute movies with just amazing creativity that you'll never see in Hollywood.
People still have the drive and the passion to do that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and so that's the benefit. The bad part is it's gone. There'll never be any, you know, there's very few movies nowadays that I'll personally wait in line for.
Sure.
Like, there's no reason for me to do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know.
I don't know. Yeah, it's, like Ryan just said, I mean, they're really not putting much thought into things as much as they used to. There are the few that still do.
There's too much.
But it's far and in between.
More about the money and less about the art. You know? But there are still certain sects. There's still people that try to keep the art in it, and you know you can find those people, and that kind of cream always rises to the top. You know, yeah. So,
have you ever heard of the term Hollywood accounting?
Yeah.
Do you know? Apparently, was it the movie? It's with Tom Hanks. It's Forrest Gump. has never actually technically made any money on the Hollywood bank accounts.
Right.
Wow.
Apparently, the author never got paid for it.
Sure. That happens all the time.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we're still in the red over here. Sorry, the advertising budget, you know, was this
for,
amount.
For Lord of the Rings, Peter Jackson had to sue New Line Cinema to get the profits he was due.
He probably had to hire an auditor to go and look at their actual books so he could even have a lawsuit.
Yeah, so much so that during The Hobbit, they had, is it Gil Del Toro?
Guillermo del Toro?
Yeah, they actually had him direct it because they didn't want anything to do with Peter Jackson. And
right.
What happened is New Line Cinema was actually close to losing the rights. So the family of Tolkien basically said, that's okay, we're not going to renew a New Line and give the rights solely to Peter Jackson.
Right.
They actually said that. They said, New Line, you're done. If you don't film it within this certain period of time, you'll never get it again.
Wow.
You know, so that's what it comes down to. People who love the film or the source material will always make the best directors.
Yeah.
I think the movies we've picked this year or last year is proof of it.
Yeah.
So before we finish up the shenanigans episode, you have anything to finish up with, James Ryan?
Good.
No, I'm good, man. Go out and watch a movie this holiday season, y'all.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, ladies and gentlemen, for Jonathan Charney, James Stevens, and Ryan Preston, we'll see you next week.
This episode of Old Guy Tech TV is brought to you by Ward's Automotive, specializing in Banks Power and Pack Brake, servicing your car or truck, and specializing in diesel engines. Over 30 years of service, located in Diamond Springs, California, give them a call at 530-626-5588.